College of Business Alumni Association, the College of Business, and the Nevada Alumni Association. Welcome to Doug Raftery, CEO of Reno ACES. Welcome, Doug.
Thanks, Tom. Appreciate it. Thanks, Chris and team for setting it up. See some familiar faces, to say the least. And, happy to update on what's going on at the stadium and some twists and turns, to say the least, over 2020. And what we're assuming is into 2021 as well. And I want to leave some time for some back and forth and Q&A and happy to be transparent about what's going on. So just a little background. I came to Reno 2016, was the senior director of corporate partnerships, stepped into the VP role, and then most recently was the general manager for Reno 1868 FC, obviously one of the twists and turns that we've experienced, having to shut down the club, unfortunately. And most recently stepped in as the COO. So I work with our operations and our events and entertainment teams, along with our corporate and community partners as well. From New Jersey, went to a small Division III school out in Maryland called Hood College, played soccer out there and love it. I'm a huge fan of four-year institutions and the quality and product that it provides. So, obviously 2020 was a tough year for many. I think once sports, whether that be March Madness for basketball or the NBA in particular, it became a domino effect when those things were postponed. And I remember the phone calls back in March where we had an exhibition game for Reno 1868 in late February. And in a couple of days, we're prepared to have our home opener and had already played actually the weekend before in our regular season opener. In Tacoma, which, if you recall, was actually one of the initial hotspots of COVID breaking out. And guys were freaked out, to say the least. And obviously, soon we learned what was going on. Baseball was canceled. Soccer was postponed. And then all of a sudden, the United Soccer League, the league that we were in, decided that they wanted to try their hand at playing while nothing else was going on, and thought that it was an opportunity really to be at the forefront of sports coming back. Our first game in Sacramento in July was on ESPN2, which was really neat. But at the same time, it financially was extremely difficult from a COVID standpoint. Obviously, we did not have fans until our two playoff matches in October. We had 200 and then 700 fans at our playoff games. And throughout all the travel, COVID testing, we would test anywhere 1 to 3 times per week. The 3 times per week usually were when things went south, which did occur. No matter how hard we tried to be in a bubble, but we were traveling commercially, we weren't on private jets, and costs added up quickly, along with fees and structure and things that you still had to pay for, with unfortunately no revenue coming in the door. So we, obviously made the decision to shut down Reno 1868 for various reasons, but COVID being the main play in that. And now looking at opportunity opportunity to focus on the main business unit for the reason the stadium was built, and that's baseball, and then also to provide additional opportunity in terms of events being hosted at the stadium. A little bit of background, certainly have, we're treading water, but attempting to support the community, early on, just providing spaces in our parking lots, the stadium for food bank distribution. We donated it. We actually had past jerseys for baseball and soccer. We made them into masks, which was really neat. And we, donated over $10,000 to, the 6 local hospitals, the 2 out in Tahoe region, 3 in Reno, and then the one down in Carson as well, which was used for financial help at that time. That was like April, May, for daycare services for healthcare employees. So that was really neat. And then most recently, we've done a couple of Christmas things. We do work with Jack's Pacific to donate thousands and thousands of toys to nonprofits around town, including Ashley's Toy Closet, Carson Sheriff's Department, Reno Rodeo Foundation, among many others. And then we'll see, but we have offered the stadium for use to the county and the state for first mass COVID testing, and then second, any mass vaccination opportunities. So we're just trying to be there. Certainly those things don't provide, you know, that much. It's not really expenses on behalf of the organization, just more space and opportunity to be a good community player. You know, 2021, listen, I think we're all in the same boat, right? Every day we live in what you just went through with your golf tournament, in regards to what is happening, how many people can we host? When do we get in touch with the county and the state? Do they even want to hear from us right now with it being January 14th? And is baseball starting in April? And a couple of things. Number one, baseball has changed a bit in terms of the structure. For simplicity's sake, minor league baseball and major league baseball, in the past, it was, I'm going to call it an affiliation. It is now run by Major League Baseball. Major League Baseball had to make some decisions in minor league baseball to reduce the amount of teams from 162 to 120. We're fortunate to have been one of those 120 from single A to triple A, if you will. And we'll now have a new league. We will play more regionalized play and are just going through the process of finalizing that. Now, that's not COVID related. That agreement between the affiliation side of things expired in September. However, it has taken some negotiation and we are still in the process of finalizing all of that over the course of this month. So we have been told that things look good to play baseball in April. That has been the most recent news, particularly for our level. Might be different for the single A and double A levels. We're at the triple A level, the level right below Major League Baseball. And it sounds like that's the direction they'd like to move. A lot of players from the players union have been told that triple A major league players are planning to report for spring training in Florida and Arizona in February as normal. Now we're working off of the best information that we have today. So whether that happens or not is to be seen. But even going back now 2 months prior to today, that's not something we necessarily expected in terms of the message. So we're kicking our butts into a little higher gear, preparing for things, especially with corporate partners that we normally would be doing in a normal year. But instead of planning for a delay, we're just planning for a normal start in the beginning of April. And then if there is a delay, it is what it is. And then events and entertainment. Without soccer, obviously there's more opportunity to have additional community events. We are focusing on, you know, call it galas, private events, corporate events, more of that summer timeframe to fill those weekends. You know, those who maybe had events indoors who don't feel as comfortable, but might feel more comfortable booking it in an open air facility like Great Nevada Field. That is kind of turned into business unit number two, if you will, in regard to the Aces and now events and entertainment. And we are certainly looking at the concert side of things as well, and trying to enter that phase for an on-field concert. And then, you know, we're trying to, you know, keep ourselves motivated in regards to understanding the marketplace. A lot of ticket products, for example, we have just had a set amount of games and a particular you have to choose the games from a ticket plan perspective. So actually late this week, as in tomorrow, we are releasing a new ticket package that's a very low cost, refundable, a flex option pretty much to attempt to give people a little bit more comfort in regards to choosing a lower amount of games and not set to, there's no schedule right now. So pretty much it's at your flex, at your ability to choose those games that you'll come to. And then throughout this entire time, I think it's been cool. I think everybody, right, all of us have probably learned what we've had opportunity to focus on some things that we haven't maybe been able to in the past. So we've worked with a company called The Table Group. If anyone's familiar with Patrick Lencioni, well-known author, he has a company called The Table Group, which basically puts his practices and his books into play. Last November of 2019, at this point, we had as a leadership team got together with a table group and now have defining objectives as an organization. Among some of those, employee engagement and training. We have two different levels of a leadership team and kind of a VP and director level to allow more cascading within our organization and decision-making without everyone being in the same meeting at one time, which was happening a lot. Win Our Way is another one, our guest experience. We're realizing that sanitation and cleaning are two different terms and words that will be used moving forward, ways that we greet our fans, et cetera. Supporting the community, we have a pillar on that virtually would like two events per month for our staff to attend. And then increasing our ecosystem. So we put together a committee internally. We know that a lot of new people and businesses continue to move to this region, whether that be in the housing market or whatever it might be. And we know that our attendance is going to be limited, but we're keeping in touch with new people, letting them know that we're here for the future and more of a long-term play. And then really the biggest of things is, quite frankly, figuring out how to value our partnerships, doing it the right way, making sure that we earn the business that we do provide, not trying to provide make goods, and really just laying it out and being transparent with our partners of if we're at XYZ capacity, that is what it is. And on the back end, that's pretty much what is going to be earned on behalf of us. And then attendance capacities obviously affect season ticket members, how many we have, building a bunch of different scenarios based on percentages, how close people can be, which is very difficult to dial in because for our soccer playoff matches, it was groups no larger than six and all of them had to be 6 feet away. That could be way different moving forward, especially when we talk about vaccination period, how group outings are going to be viewed. Normally we have, you know, five different groups of 50 in our Coors Light party zone down the left field line. We don't necessarily think that could be a thing in 2021. So looking at those as exclusive areas for groups, maybe companies will be a little bit more comfortable doing that rather than being with additional companies together. And then the final thing really that we're working on right now is digital purchasing for items that maybe we only offer through a phone call typically, is being able to, you can buy a Tesla or go to Carvana.com and buy a car online right now. Why shouldn't you be able to buy a suite or a season-long lease for a suite or maybe even a sign in the outfield? You know, all of our ticket options, maybe some sponsorship options and offering that from a digital perspective. So we're working with our partners who can build those things out and offering that stuff. So I think like for all of us, things have just changed. I wanted to keep it brief. That was, you know, a lot of stuff in a short amount of time, but, you know, would love to take questions about the state of the stadium, baseball, any questions on soccer, et cetera, and kind of just have a back and forth, Tom.
Oh, thank you so much. I'll open up to the board. Anybody has any first questions?
Well, I'll start off first, Doug. You know, obviously, you know, we kind of have a shared past when it comes to sports and whatnot. I think in your mind, you know, what has kind of been the most surprising aspect of, you know, I guess the unfortunate circumstances of 1868 and, you know, what's kind of been like the most, you know, I guess inspiring element of that happening. Obviously, everyone's had to have some kind of form of difficulty this last, you know, almost year now. But what's something that you and your staff have kind of rallied around?
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult, right? I mean, people lost their jobs. So it was hard. You know, I find myself to be one of the fortunate ones and love this area and this community, and some weren't as fortunate. So that was difficult. However, you know, I would say that from a community standpoint, it's been really refreshing. I don't know if people are doing it because they feel bad for us, but we've had a lot of partners and season ticket members, et cetera, just keep credit and not ask for a refund, which is extremely important for us to live. And then number two is that with soccer going away, we did have, obviously, a large number of partners commit dollars to soccer partnerships. And I would say that there are a lot of partners, and very grateful for this, that have at least been open to shifting that over to a different use. So Obviously we're losing a business unit, but maybe they'll sponsor an event moving forward. Maybe they add baseball elements, or they want to add suites or whatever it is moving forward, and that we're able to carry that money over from soccer and enhance and not lose that. So I would say that's really cool to see from a community standpoint, that people are actually open to that and not just saying, ah, we're just going to stop. Soccer no longer exists. So that's been cool.
Hi, Doug. This is Spencer. I just had a quick question regarding that the MLB has basically taken over minor league baseball. Does that put you guys in a better position in terms of kind of being able to weather through some of the COVID losses and things like that? Do they give you support in that regard, or how does that work?
Yeah, you know, I can't dive into the financial side of things, but I will say what it does, I think, is it provides us a backbone to knowing that we are part of their plans, and that we have been invited and will be an Arizona Diamondbacks affiliate, and that we are going to receive players to be able to perform everything that we perform. Obviously, there is no partnerships or members or anything like that without players actually being on the field. So I think it provides an extended opportunity for us just to feel comfortable that the stadium lease and having baseball, et cetera, will continue on for at least, you know, another 10 years within this partnership. So I think it's just a comfort level in that regard, more so than anything else. We are still owned by, we have an owner himself. We have an individual ownership group. So we're not owned by Major League Baseball, but Major League Baseball kind of just, they run the ship now in terms of, you know, the scheduling, what facility needs and wants are, and you know, nutrition for players, all that stuff was kind of handled separately by the clubs. And now it's just more of an integrated partnership is how I would call it.
How's the rest of the greater Nevada field? I mean, for people like me that haven't left the house since March, is the Freight House still opened up, or is that?
Yeah, we're shut down right now. So we don't currently have a food service company or anything like that. And right before COVID, we did that restaurant we used to have down on the corner. It used to be a Arroyo Mexican restaurant, and then it was Red's Broken Bat. So they actually headed out right before COVID, and we were in the search of looking for a new restaurant partner there. But all that's shut down right now. It's just financially and from a revenue perspective that it doesn't make sense for us to do it. So we probably moving forward, even for that restaurant piece, for the Freight House, et cetera, we are looking for an external vendor to come in and we want to do what we do best, and that's not restaurants. we want our facilities from we have Pro Sports Catering, that's who runs all the suites and stuff like that. We want them to be able to focus on their niche and focus on that stuff. So we'll see what happens in the future, but for right now, that's quiet.
You mentioned a little bit about, you know, the players and what has that been like? I mean, what is your guys' support that you offer to the players during this time? I mean, they're probably all at home like everybody else is. And what's your guys' involvement from a day-to-day with the players?
Yeah, when soccer was going on, we did, players were paid. That was status quo in regards to them performing their contracts. That's where baseball and soccer is actually really neat internally, because it was, the two sports are so different, and they will continue to be, in that you paid your soccer players. It was just more of you weren't given players, they were your signed players. Whereas in baseball, and it still will be this way, and it always has been, the Diamondbacks pay and they send the players to Reno. So we actually have no involvement from what their decisions are in terms of paying any major league or minor league players based on their contractual terms. So to be honest, I'm not quite sure how they're being handled. Every organization's done it differently in terms of paying their players through it or not paying their players through it. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the Diamondbacks have continued to pay their minor league players whereas some decided that they're going to cut it at a certain time frame in the middle of COVID.
Is there a level of comfort for the players? Are they just as worried about COVID, or is just playing and getting into the major leagues the only thing on their mind?
I would say, based off of what I experienced with soccer, there is a balance that I think it's probably like anyone in this group. It's your own personal viewpoint on things, and you know, how what risks you're willing to take. I think personally, it's evident that when you know, the players, I think, started to realize that as long as they kept themselves in their own little bubble, and their families within their own little bubble, that they were able to focus more of their time and energy on the actual sport. Whereas, you know, some teams had major, major outbreaks. We didn't. So I think it's going to probably be the same thing from a baseball standpoint, that if the group itself feels comfortable with each other, and depending on what the rules and regulations are that Major League Baseball puts into play for these guys, you know, if they're not going to be loosey-goosey, right, in terms of allowing them to go out for non-essentials and stuff like that, then they should be able to focus on the sport and progressing more than anything else. But I think no matter what, there's going to be a hesitation, you know, of coming in every day and working with guys who, you know, and there's more guys in baseball than soccer, you know, call it 40 something people plus their families. I think that it's always going to exist until there's a true vaccination effort. So I think that's, you know, it's tough to answer right now, but that's kind of what I gathered from at least playing in a season last year.
Okay.
Doug, quick question for you. What's your guys' expectation, right? We're hoping for seating capacity and what that looks like, and how many fans are you guys hoping to get in the seats and all that with all the restrictions?
100%. That's what we hope. But there's no expectation. You know, we are open to having an open conversation with the county and the state, similar to like we did for soccer. You know, were we pleased at that time with 200 or 700? No. However, we believe that we can do it safely. We have any model that you can think of for however many thousand of fans, we've got it. And whatever the local authority says at that time, the great news is that we're able to press the go button. So if it's 500, it's 500. If it's 3,000, it's 3,000. And we're going to be able to showcase what that looks like from a digital stadium build of how many people would be in X amount of seats. But there's some customization with it too that's going to exist based on whatever those current guidelines are. Me, myself, I'm hopeful that we can open with anywhere from 10 to 30% in the beginning of the season, but that's not based off of anything at all.
It's your own estimate. That's good. Anything's good right now, right?
Yeah.
All right. We're at 1 o'clock. Do you have any really last quick questions, or?
I just had one more quick question. And maybe this is managed more at the Diamondbacks level, but are teams going to be requiring their players to get vaccinated to play?
Good question. I think every business is going through that, and each team is a business. I suspect that when there is a vaccination that's readily available, I do think that all players will have to be vaccinated. That's just based on rumblings that are out there. But I think there's too much money, I hate to say that, at stake for all sports for them not to require that from a player perspective. So I see that being the direction that it would go down. But in the end, I think it's going to be Major League Baseball's choice. I don't think it's going to be team by team's choice. I think Major League Baseball is going to make the decision. And then the teams are probably going to have to enact whatever that decision is.
Well, Doug, thank you so much for coming on and talking to us. This is a much anticipation on the following season. So we hope the best, and nice. Hopefully we can get out some season baseball as well. So.
You got it. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Absolutely.